There is no teaching more important than the continuity fear teaching. For example, this morning I was feeling so depressed, feeling like nothing's ever happened, nothing's ever going to happen. It's the worst thing possible. It's just, and then I said, wait a minute, two mornings ago, I was virtually abiding in the non-dual absolute awareness, and seeing all the resistance, seeing through it all, and basically almost, you know, total success. And so how could I be saying this? It's crazy. What the problem is we think that our problem is we're not getting anywhere. The fact is, it's exactly the opposite. We're having too much success. And our continuity fear is like, whoa, slow down, this is too much. And that can throw you into a feeling of depression. If you don't recognize it, you just feel like, oh, I gotta quit. This isn't working. This is what this rhetoric, inner rhetoric for me is coming up saying, you just gotta give up, you gotta quit. Nothing you've done has worked. You've never gotten any help. You know, just super negativity coming. Where's that coming from? Coming from the continuity fear. Continuity fear, because what happened was I saw my freedom. I said, wow, I don't have to be bound by any of this at all. And the freedom was just so total. I just, you know, the continuity fear said, wait a minute, this is too much. This is too much success. So it slams on the brakes and tries to tell you, no, you got to quit. And why you have to quit? Because nothing you've done has ever had the slightest bit of success. You've never received any help. On and on and on and on and on. I said, just wait a minute. I was just on the brink of total success. How could I have not had a lot of success? You know, it's a disconnect. It's irrational. So the continuity fear makes fools of us all and has this very irrational viewpoint. The purpose is to get us to stop. And then if you stop, then it will seem just, then you'll really feel like, oh, maybe I am going to fail. And then they'll say, you see, I told you you're going to fail. So the continuity fear wants us to fail. This world, most of the attitude in this world is designed for us to fail, for sure. Because this world is literally an expression of the continuity fear. It's the continuity fear expressing itself. That's what this world is. So every morning when you wake up, it's very important to practice the continuity practice. I don't have a success problem. I have a continuity problem. The success problem doesn't exist. Therefore, it has no value whatsoever. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. This is the way to go about it. I do not have a success problem at all. I have a very severe continuity problem. The success problem doesn't exist. How could it? Actually, we're succeeding incredibly well. So how can we have a success problem? We don't. I don't have a problem with a success. I'm being incredibly successful. But the continuity fear twists it and says, no, you're like being super unsuccessful. You better stop the direction you're going in. It's dead ending and total failure. I said, no, wait a minute. I was just on the brink of total success. How can you say it's dead ending and total failure? That's completely irrational. So I do not have a success problem. I have a continuity problem. A success problem doesn't exist. Therefore, it has no value for me, absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And it's necessary to recognize the role that this continuity fear is playing in your mentation. Otherwise, you will get depressed, you will get despondent, you will be confused. You'll be very confused. You say, wait a minute, I thought I was on the brink of success and now I'm feeling like I've never gotten anywhere. And this confusion, like what's going on? I'm so confused. But when you identify the problem, say, oh, yeah, the continuity fear is kicking up. It really kicked up for me yesterday. And wow. I was trying to get my mind off of the success, trying to focus on non-success. This world is, again, an expression of the continuity fear. Now, let us say we enter into the abidance in non-dual absolute. Well, we're going to be very peaceful and serene. And people are going to wonder, why, what happened? They're very afraid of success, keep this in mind. And so they will try to talk you out of it, for sure. So we have to have some techniques not to get talked out of it. And what I would suggest is to say, well, you know, it's as if I were entered into a foreign country, a really foreign country that I'm not at all familiar with, really. So, but it's very wonderful. It's just that I really can't explain it at this point. It's so foreign to me. I don't really have any any particular explanation to give at this point. I need to gain some familiarity with it. And then you did say, well, rather than try to get into that, I'd rather focus on what's helpful, which is the big picture context, which is the continuity problem that everybody has, and how that interferes with progress all the way along, and how this world is nothing but an expression of the continuity fear. And if you want to get free of this world, you have to evaporate your continuity fear. There's no other way around it. And this continuity fear will dog you every step of the way, actually, every step of the way. Because actually, your problem is not failure, it's success. Okay? Your problem is not that you're failing. The problem is that you're moving towards success and it's scaring the heck out of you. We're all terrified by the fact that we can be free of delusion. We can drop our stance of hallucination. We're afraid of success. We say, oh my gosh, I'm going to be totally free and totally happy. And it's like a foreign country. I don't know how to function in this country. So we sabotage our success constantly. This world is really an apostate world of sabotaging success. It's dedicated to sabotaging success. There's no question about that. Having been here in this world many, many times, and this world very consciously saying, okay, I'm going to be very conscious coming into this world and let's see what happens. Ah, I found out what's going on here. Sabotaging success. And celebrating this sabotage of success. Everybody spends their time saying, oh, I've done a great job this lifetime sabotaging my success. I've been very successful in avoiding success. This is the definition of success in this world, that avoiding success is success. So it's you know, the opposite of sanity, actually. So there is no practice more important, no awareness more important than the continuity practice. Without that, you will be befuddled and you will sabotage your success, actually. And you will begin agreeing with the world that maybe you're crazy. Maybe it's all a hoax. Maybe you're all wrong. Maybe what you're doing is bad. Maybe what you... And I said, wait a minute, I was just on the verge of abidance without much fear, feeling, yeah, I can do this, which is the ultimate success. And then the next day I said, I've had no success at all. You see, it's just absolutely nuts. And yet that is what happens. That is what happens, which is why we're frightened of success, of progress on the path, because we know that there's going to be backlash. Of course there will be backlash. So what we have to do is factor this backlash in, understand it will be there, and this requires what's called patience and perseverance. I know everybody is looking for some magic way for there to be no backlash. And there just isn't any such magic way. There isn't. That's the rabbit hopping all over the place. Do you have a magic pill for me? Do you have a magic pill? Oh, there's one over here? Okay, I'll jump over there. Oh, and the rabbit is just, and the tortoise is just saying, wow, going slowly. Why? Because the continuity fear is like slowing it down. Just like, oh man, this is difficult. Because every step I take, I feel like it's difficult because the continuity fear is saying, whoa, slow down. You're having too much success. You're getting too close to the answer. And the rabbit's hopping all over the place saying, anyone have a magic pill? Anyone have a magic pill? Anyone have a magic pill? There is no magic pill. Never will be, because this is a continuity issue. It's not an intellectual issue at all. It's a continuity issue. And we're just saying, wow, I don't know how to function in such a foreign country where, you know, I realize there's no layers and levels, no pit. You know, I don't need to, no needs. You know, it's just, everything is like, wow, foreign country. How can I function in that? And so we have to gradually get closer and closer and feeling, move our comfort zone. There isn't any other way. And the continuity fear is so powerful that it constantly cons us into believing there's some other way. Because what it's saying is, under no circumstances do I ever want to go to that foreign country. So I'm going to spend all my time with some other objective. Or avoiding this gradualism of, you know, evaporating the continuity fear. Says, no, I'm looking for a better way. I want to do it all at once. And so this world is always looking for a better way. Okay, you'll find that in this world. Everybody feels like they're smarter, you know, that they're going to outsmart the situation. And they say, well, you know, at some point I know I'm going to be able to outsmart it. And they never even get started on the path. This is the whole problem of the world. But those who do get started, you know, people say, you know, how dumb. I mean, if you just wait a little while, you know, certainly scientists are going to find an answer for this. Totally wrong. How can scientists find an answer for what is fundamentally a continuity fear, a familiarity fear? There is no magic answer for familiarity fear. You don't. You have to experience it in order to know what it is. You know, it's not possible to solve a familiarization problem by remaining unfamiliar. It simply is impossible. What they're really saying is, wait a little while, and science will come up with some inventions that'll make this world, you know, more palatable, and we won't have to worry about abiding in the non-dual absolute reality of the totality of all that is. We won't have to do that. This is the continuity fear's objective. But people pose as if, I don't want to struggle. I'm not going to struggle on the path. As soon as they feel some backlash and struggle, okay. I've got to wait a while until that's not there anymore. It's a familiarity problem. The more you wait, the worse it gets. That's why all the great teachers insist you must do everything possible in your time here in this world to spend every day, every moment, as much as possible, focused on spiritual path, evaporating the resistance. I call it the continuity fear. Continuity fear has to be evaporated. Otherwise, you're going to fall into this delusion of cleverness. And the clever people, the way they dress, the way they look, you know, it's like they're saying, I'm like super clever. I found a way around this. And when I die, I'll go to heaven. You know, that kind of thing. I'll reach that when I die, you know, or something. But they're just saying they're being clever. They think they're being smart in avoiding the path. See, I'm smart enough. I don't have to do that work. You know, there's this feeling in the world like that avoiding doing the difficult work, the real difficult work, is the whole goal, the whole objective, and that's winning the game. And we're all in this game, winning the game, but it's actually losing the game. So you have a world full of losers, but the problem is losers oftentimes get band together into an activist mindset of saying that losing is winning. Right? Well, but it's not. But the pressure on this world is so extreme that losing is winning. That if you're an actual winner, you feel like a loser here. So powerful is this mindset. So now we're told in scripture that Jesus is coming back to this world. Well, what did he say? He said to Simon Peter, asked him, well, where are you going? And I think this is John 13, and then going into John 14. Where are you going? Simon Peter asked him. And Jesus says, where I'm going, you cannot follow now. But later you'll be able to. You'll be able to later. Okay. Where I'm going, you're not able to follow now. But you'll be able to later. In my Father's mansion are many rooms. If it weren't so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And then return for you, and so that you can abide with me there. This is paraphrasing the gist of it. Now, why would something like this take place? Well, as I just said, this world has this very activist belief that losing is winning. So it's becoming increasingly difficult to actually win here. Okay. Because you feel that you're like just an extreme loser. It may get to the point where this world is so dedicated to delay and trying to outsmart themselves and refusing to do the work necessary and insisting that they're winners, that losing is winning, that maybe it's necessary for those who really do want to make progress to reconsider, you know, where their dwelling place is. Where do they want to hang out? Do you really want to hang out with those who are champions of non-recognition, non-recognizing the continuity fear, those who are in the grip of the continuity fear, celebrating it as if it's some sort of victory? The insane, do you really want to hang out who are claiming that insanity is sanity, who are championing that? We're told that this attitude gets so severe here that even those who are electing for sanity and non-dual abidance, they will feel as if they're mistaken and they're wrong and they need to not do that. That's how bad, and the situation's already that bad here. So I went from a situation of near enlightenment to feeling like I was a complete loser. And where does that come from? It comes from the continuity fear. But the continuity fear is not just mine. It's a collective continuity fear in this world. It is a collective continuity fear here in this world. It permeates. You get it from everywhere. It just permeates this world. The belief system of this world just permeates everybody's attention. Wherever you go, there's attention in this world. Okay, wherever you go, there's attention. Even all the plants have attention. They have attention to light and moisture and all that. Everything has attention here. So as you move about this world, you're moving about in a field of attention. What are we paying attention to? And so all interactions inherently are interactions of attention with attention. Some people call it consciousness. Everything that's consciousness is really I prefer the term attention. What are you paying attention to? Because attention is something that you can direct, you see. So, Others just prefer conscious. I've never resonated with that term for some reason. I don't know. It's not active enough for me. Attention is very active. Where are you? So as you go about the world, you're interacting with attention constantly, constantly. There's no way around it. And if this world's attention is on denial of realization, enlightenment, thinking that that's winning, denial of the spiritual path, believing that this is the smart winning play, you're getting all this pressure from the attention of the world to abandon your success. And this is what Jesus is saying, that even the elect, the saints of God, will be in danger of abandoning their success, abandoning their non-dual position, their non-dual realization, their non-dual abidance. Their non-dual presence. And we're certainly at that stage right now. Now, some people feel that, what's that? Something significant will take place. September 25th, 2:14, Feast of Trumpets, and a Jewish feast day. Many people believe that the return of Jesus or something related to Jesus, it will take place on the Feast of Trumpets. That's only a few days away, actually. It would be very good timing, actually. Very good timing. I'd say the time is now. The time is now. Because the act of a celebration of losing as winning is going to become insufferable here, actually. It's going to become insufferable. And, you know, I have not been able to find any way to make any inroads into it. It's getting worse and worse and worse. So I would only give a heads up to those who are in the same boat, recognize, hey, wait a minute. I don't want to become one of those who believes that losing is winning. That spiritual duality is winning. And everything that goes with that. That fear is winning. That imprisonment is winning. That delusion is winning. That insanity is winning. And so we keep our attention on the dynamics of the spiritual path, the continuity, fear, and the overall mindset of the world. Many people, those who've been on the spiritual path often leave the world of ordinary attention and go to someplace, Himalaya mountains, monasteries, where others who share their attention congregate. So they feel reinforced by that. Okay, good. I got a little more time here. That's great. Because this is food for the soul, food for the spirit. So they would congregate. They would go somewhere, out in a desert, somewhere away from the ordinary pressures of the idea that losing is winning. And putting your attention on losing, meaning delay, not taking up the spiritual path, not trying to evaporate the continuity fear, rather than trying to increase the continuity fear. They think that if the continuity fear just gets so severe, magically, they won't need to, you know, return to sanity. they'll be happy within insanity, within fear. That fear will become a happy experience for us. This is delusion. But they think that strengthening delusion is the answer. This is insanity. That's why the insane, their purpose is to try and strengthen insanity. So those who realize this is not the way would try to escape the world, go somewhere in the forest, the jungle, away from all this stuff. But in today's world, that is not really that plausible anymore. Because the goal of this world is this one world order. Okay, order, meaning bring order to the world. We're going to have a bureaucratic system of bringing order to the world that permeates the entire planet. This is their objective. Okay, let's talk about the new world order. Now we have, you know, local government, giving various freedoms here and there. And what they want is just one government with a massive bureaucracy that administers the entire planet, okay, and everybody on this planet. Everybody will be bound by the same rules, same regulations, everywhere, okay? So keep this in mind, that what we're headed for is a new world order. And know what this is: bringing order and structure, which means laws and regulations, to every person who lives on this planet, apply all to equally. So this is not some freewheeling world anymore where you can say, you know what, I'm going to take off and live in the jungle or something. It's not like, no, that the jungle is going to be regulated too. Very much so. Very much so. The environmental concerns or whatever, but everybody is going to have, you know, identification, have to be identified. What's your identification? All digitally, you know, the whole world be connected. Satellites, data banks, servers, cloud servers. And wherever you are, they will know where you are. Okay. And you cannot just be some person who doesn't exist in this world, who's hiding. It's not going to work that way. They'll go into every cave on this planet, as a matter of fact. You think, oh no. Oh yes, oh yes, oh yes. They'll have drones, okay, searching you out. They will have drones searching you out. They're already now working on delivering packages via drones. Drones are everywhere. The cameras on drones, a lot of the photography you see, nature photography, really great stuff, is simply drones with a small digital camera mounted on a drone, the drone being remotely flown. They will remotely, they have satellites photographing every aspect of this planet. They can photograph like a nickel, I think, or something. And maybe to see actually on a ground, they'll actually, that's how good the resolution of the photography is of the satellites. If you think you're going to be in the outback hiding out somewhere, they'll have drones with cameras. The satellites will locate something. Drones will go there and be able to actually spy on you and say, what are you doing? And they'll be able to, you know, we're already there. We're already there. And this is the will of the losers, those who say that losing is winning. They don't want any winning on this planet. They make this very clear. They don't want anybody to win here. They want everyone to lose. They think if everybody loses, this will create a magical solution. This is what's called magical belief, magical thinking. This is the fear, the continuity fear is driving this called magical thinking, magical belief. The people of this world are in the grip of this magical belief that losing is winning. And for the most part, they go along with this whole agenda. They say, yeah, we need to win. We really need to win here. And so we need to do it what everybody really agrees upon. And if most people agree upon that losing is winning, then that's what we need to do. People think, oh, no, I'm going to go up to Canada or somewhere and live out. No, they'll have every square centimeter of Canada under surveillance. They'll have every square centimeter of this planet under constant surveillance. You will not be able to buy food, gas, do anything. Now you think, well, I'll be some survivalist up in the Rocky Mountains or something. Well, they'll have all that under surveillance too. They'll have drones tracking you down. They don't have to have people anymore tracking you down. They'll have drones up in the air, panoramic cameras. I mean, just 360 degree cameras, infrared. You know, they'll be tracking you with infrared. Hunters right now are using drones, infrared drones, to track animals, like wild boar, for instance. They won't go. They do in the night. They have the drones go up with infrared in the nighttime, and they locate where the wild boar are. And then they say, okay, and they come in the nighttime. You know, they know where they are. So if you think that you're just going to be some survivalist, forget it. Forget it. They've got that covered entirely. So the New World Order is is here, actually. Ideology is that losing is winning. It's Orwellian, as we were told. It's an expression of continuity fear. It is the expression of the continuity fear, unrecognized as such, as if strengthening the continuity fear is the answer. Of course, the continuity fear is always going to say that strengthening it is the answer. So they say, hey, if we all just lose together, that's going to strengthen the continuity fear. If we all just delay more, and then they say, well, then that'll result in our happiness. But it doesn't, because the desire to drop the stance of hallucination that we have, and the fear, the dread of annihilation this brings up, this is inherent within us. We know there's true happiness. Is our true birthright, is our true inheritance. We inherently don't like fear. We can never be happy with fear, but that's not how we were created to function. So this path of strengthening the continuity fear cannot ever succeed. And the New World Order becomes more and more and more tyrannical, saying, wow, we just somehow, somebody, you know, someone's still trying to succeed somewhere. We just can't figure out scapegoating and blaming. We need more regulations. Somewhere on the cosmos, we need to branch out in the cosmos and bring our ideology of losers, losing is winning, to some other places, you know. And it's like that. So the motto might be, we all have to lose together. Losing together is happiness. This is the world. You know, the world, this is the world. Oh, we all have to die. You come here to die. We come here to lose. We need to reinforce for one another that we're losers, and being a loser is great. So certainly they don't want to see any winners here, because people might say, hey, wait a minute. What's that? I kind of feel an attraction to that. You know, oh, no. The thought police, you know, spring to the defense of continuity fear. So what repentance is realizing that losing is not winning, and it will never be winning. That there really is this beautiful country, land, that this beautiful state, this beautiful oneness, vision of oneness that we can have. And that's what we really want. And you realize all this, you say, wow, I've got a lot of work ahead of me. That's called repentance. So repentance is kind of like you say, oh, it's good news. Losing is not winning. Losing is not winning. I can win, but it's going to take quite a bit of work because I have this continuity fear. So you're kind of, the repentant are not, you know, they're serious. Pensive, serious, dedicated. Say, I got a lot of work I got to do here. They're not out partying or celebrating or anything like that. They're working. They're working on this continuity, evaporating this continuity fear. This is the real responsibility of everyone in any world. Anyone who believes they're in a world, they have a severe continuity problem. There's no question about that. Even those who go to another world still have a severe continuity problem, but they maybe go to another world and they help them work on it, actually. But the attention is not, you know, demanding that we, you know, not evaporate, except make it more. But still, ultimately, the true realization is that nothing's ever happened to reality. Reality is exactly the same way as it's always been, and always will be. Everything is perfectly perfect. All is exactly as it always has been. In time, no, there's never been any time. It never started, thus it never came to an end. There's never been any space. There's never been any process. There's never been any form. There's everything is absolutely perfect. That's the true realization. But you won't get there until you evaporate your continuity fear. That is for sure. And you can evaporate it enough so you can be right on the verge of it. But still, the continuity fear is there. You still have to keep working on it. And this is as one would expect. As one would expect. So trying to understand what will happen in this world. Certainly, evaporating the continuity fear, one feels that it's all important that they be in control of their attention and actually give the attention to the Holy Spirit. That's all important. So where do you want my attention to be, Holy Spirit? That is the basic mood of repentance. Where do you want my attention to be? You put my attention where you know is going to be most helpful. Now, fortunately, the Holy Spirit has infinite patience. So everybody, no matter how severe their continuity fear is, will be saved. Everyone will be. The Holy Spirit will stay working with everyone, and eventually everyone will evaporate the continuity fear without any exception. Nobody will be lost. Nobody will remain in this continuity fear. But that could take quite a lot of patience, for sure. But that's okay. The Holy Spirit has infinite patience. That's not our job. Our job is to accept our own salvation. Okay, so our job is to say, Holy Spirit, where do you want my attention to be? And let the Holy Spirit be in charge of our lives, meaning our attention. When we say our lives, we mean our attention. Where is our attention? Now, the New World Order, global bureaucracy, and rules and regulation, Big Mother Network, where everybody is included. In fact, they say this is a privilege to be included, but we don't want to deprive you of this privilege, so we're going to drag you out of your caves and make sure that you participate in this great privilege of believing that losing is winning. They want to control your attention. That's why I say there's this war going on, spiritual war for your attention. And this New World Order wants to dictate to everyone on the planet how the flow of their attention, to regulate their attention, to regulate everyone's attention, to tell everyone where their attention has to be and where it must avoid being, you see. This is the central issue involved in all of this. It's a war for our attention. So, of course, if you allow the New World Order to dictate to you where your attention is going to be, and it will certainly be structured such that the demand and the pressure will be overwhelming for everybody on this planet. That's certainly a tough road to go. Now, the Holy Spirit can, even under those circumstances, help out for sure. But it's not a, you know, an ideal situation. What the Holy Spirit likely will have to do is gradually bring about some turnaround, so people start thinking about phase one. Maybe I need to get into phase one. Phase one starts with repentance and glimpsing the true goal, and then realizing, wow, I got a lot of work to do. That's phase one. Phase one might take a long time, because a lot of people in phase one, they're still believing that God is some angry, vicious, vindictive force that will kill their enemies for them if they worship God. Many people believe that, even those in phase one who they still think that, you know what, God is going to come back and kill all my enemies, and that'll make me happy. Then I'll finally be happy. All those people make me angry. Problem is everyone makes them angry. Because the to truly be happy is always with us. And we feel that as dangerous. We project that out. And we want everybody to do exactly what we want to do so we can be happy here with our continuity fear. And if somebody doesn't do that, that makes us feel like, hey, I need to find a different source of happiness. And so we start turning within, saying, and then we say, whoa, that's too scary. And then we blame this other person not doing what we want them to do for making us turn within, which frightened us. So then we turn to some God and say, God, we're worshiping you. We're doing what you want us to do. Would you please come here to this world and kill all our enemies who are not helping me feel happy here in this realm, in this dualistic mindset? You see how crazy that is? But this is what goes on. So phase one can last a long time. You don't get to phase two unless you finally drop this God is going to kill my enemies thing, okay? You cannot get to phase two until you finally drop that nonsense. And you realize, no, it's just that my continuity fear is the only issue. And when it rains, it pours. So I'm just giving you a pep talk and an overview here. Now, so at least we know what we're dealing with here. At least we know what we're dealing with. Phase two, you finally realize, hey, it's all a continuity fear. There is no angry God. No, there is no God that's going to kill my enemies, okay? That's not going to happen. The fact that people make me feel unhappy in this world, well, this world's inherently unhappy. How can anything really please me in this world? It's impossible. And so then you get into phase two. You say, I need to now figure it out. And so then you make all this progress in phase two where you really see the big picture. And then at some point you realize, I need a more streamlined approach. And then that's phase three. Phase three is more streamlined, more condensed, simpler. And then after working with phase three, you realize, I just about got it. But I still have this continuity fear issue. And then you have to use more skillful means to deal with this continuity fear issue. You end up using innovative, creative, skillful practices like the practice exercise we use. And you get a teaching that is, just incredibly evaporative. Okay, and streamline, just the ultimate. That's phase four. But phase one can last the longest time. It can be lifetime after lifetime. Keep thinking, as we've explained here. Again, it's important to see this. Is we're terrified of our true happiness. Super continuity fear there. We think that our safety is to not go back to that, and so as to maintain our fear and maintain living in this fear-based dream. So we want to be happy here, but we can't be happy here because we hate this. We hate this misery, but we can't admit this. So what we do is we believe that somebody else is capable of making us happy. The world is capable of making us happy. It just doesn't want to, or it's not cooperating. We automatically feel an anger towards other people and the world in this stance, because all inherently we want to turn towards true happiness. We can't admit that, so we have to insist that happiness is the world has it for us. It's just not giving it to us. But that brings up a tremendous fear and anger. So we think that the answer to get rid of this terrible fear and anger is to punish our enemies. Get rid of those who are not making me happy. So inherently then we feel we have this huge problem of like so much of the world is making us unhappy and we can't kill everybody, we think. So we then believe that there's some super force dynamic that we call God. We give a misapply the term God to this fantasy that then this God will come and smite all our enemies and destroy all those who are not doing what I want them to do to make me happy so I can be happy in this land of delusion and insanity and fear and don't have to turn back towards my true freedom. See, it's like somebody locked in a jail cell and they're miserable, but they feel the alternative is annihilation. So they say, I have to be happy in the jail cell, but I'm not. So they say, well, somebody over there, you know, saying that people over there, they're the ones that are making me unhappy. If it weren't for them, I'd be happy. And so we have to then project our unhappiness onto others in the world out there and feel that they're this very, very dangerous because they're not making me happy. That means I might turn within and be annihilated. So if we feel that they deserve annihilation, they're the ones that deserve annihilation. And we believe that there's some annihilator God, some force that we can pray to, which if we really do, we say, pray. We pray, God, please annihilate. You know, these, people really are saying, force. I want there to be some force that can annihilate all my enemies, and I'm praying that you do this, and I'll do anything you want me to do as long as you do this for me. This is what's going on here. So phase two starts when you drop that and say, no, God did not make death. God is not, has nothing to do with killing anything. God is total love, total peace, and is just waiting for us to, you know, evaporate our continuity fear. That's phase two. That's phase two. But it can be take a long time for those in phase one who have at least caught a glimmer. And so I know there's something I really that's better in this world, and yet they're still caught up in the continuity fear, thinking that, well, I better have both. I better be real happy here in this world, just in case. But phase two realizes, hey, now there has to be a fundamental transformation of my attention in order to be happy. I have to be able to place my attention in some other way other than where it has been, what I call upon a world, to be truly happy. And you're just not sure, you know, what it is, but you know you do have to do it. There's no way around it. That's phase two. So if you know it's impossible for God to be an angry, punishing God, it's all the ego. If you've already dropped that and say, that'll never happen for me, then you dig for deeper answers. And when you get the deeper answers, you say, wow, the answer's there, but I just can't quite get there. Then you go to phase three. You go to phase three. And phase three brings you very close to it. And then you realize, wow, I'm really close to it, but now the continuity fear is really, you know, wow, how do I do this last? And then that's phase four. Phase four is the last part, the last. So once you get into phase two, you're going to go three and four and ultimately to the five. For sure. Pretty quickly, actually. So I would imagine Jesus' dwelling place is a place for those who are in phase four. From there, from phase four, you're able to work and truly be liberated. Truly be liberated from the stance of hallucination. Truly drop it. Instead of saying, no, I can have a happy hallucination. Not really. So it's difficult to say what's going to happen in this world, but certainly those phase 1, 2, 3, and 4 do not really want to go along with this new world order. Okay, do not. Fundamentally do not. There's something within them that says that this is the opposite of what I want to do. But they're confused about what exactly they do need to do. So they feel they need to oppose, you know, and fight and struggle and stuff like that. Well, so there could be a lot of changes coming up, possible. Starting with the Feast of Trumpets, starting in a few days. It is quite possible. And I would say to everyone, keep cultivating the big picture. Every chance. What is the big picture? Continuity fear. Focusing on continuity fear automatically centers you in the big picture. Because you say, oh, I have a continuity, severe continuity fear. About what? Oh, yeah, that's right. I took the stance of hallucination, trying to be greater than God, and I'm now believe I'm dependent on what I'm hallucinating. That the hallucinator is now dependent upon the hallucination for their being, and I'm terrified if I stop this hallucination, drop the stance, I'll be annihilated. So plus, if I drop the stance, really I will feel like no stance. No stance at all. Reality doesn't have a stance. Hallucination is a stance, but reality doesn't have any position or stance. So on anything, doesn't need it. So we will feel like we won't have any stance. And we think the stance is our identity. But also deep down we realize we'll have this like perfect happiness, perfect freedom, and be just a foreign country, you know, wow. So that's a continuity fear. So immediately when we identify that we have a severe continuity fear, we start thinking about the big picture. What is the big picture? What's causing this continuity fear? And that immediately wisens you up. Immediately. It's like you're going from stupid to smart in a matter of few seconds. Stupid to smart in just very briefly, and then you feel your attention again. You suddenly feel, oh, my attention is focusing on what I want to focus on. The clouds are just parting like that. And it's necessary to keep talking about this issue, because the demands of the world that losing is winning, which is really the expression of the continuity fear of trying to reinforce itself, that's demanding that you not do this continuity exercise, not be aware of the continuity fear. It's demanding that you don't do this. So even if you've done it 1,000 times, you can still forget to do it, because the world is demanding that you don't. It's demanding where you place your attention. It says you must place it here. You know, and so you just get pulled into that. It doesn't matter how diligent you are. The collective demand here is you get pulled into it. Which makes it very difficult, to be sure. And I know, like yes, a couple days ago I had this very great clarity about it all. And I said, I know when I get up, I don't think I'm going to be able to hold on to it. You know, and I didn't. It's so frustrating. Because in a sane place, in a community of sanity, everybody's saying, brother, hold on to what your clarity, that you, your peak clarity. I want you to hold on to it. See, they're all reinforcing. Hold on to your peak clarity. By all means, don't keep your attention on that. I want you to. And then you feel empowered, like, yeah, wow, that's the right thing to do. Now, the continuity fear expressed itself in many ways. What one way is to take some halfway house and claim that's the goal and stop there. So that's also in play. There's all sorts of spiritual practitioners and practicing, etc., that are geared towards a delaying action, like, okay, a deal, let's make a deal, you can go this far, and then let's define that, this is the final point. Still keeping the continuity of fear in place. And so the world is saturated with that too. So as you see the ultimate goal, you think, wow, no, hardly anybody is focusing on this, and you think, maybe this isn't it. And you also feel like hardly anybody here is going to agree with this at all. So you feel like there's comfort in agreeing with others that where your attention should be, as if that's going to bring happiness, and so it will not. Hopefully, we'll have a big break coming up here. The timing is right. The timing is right. This new world order is going to move forward very quickly now. The technology, everything is ready. Everything is ready for it. It's just like it's a rollout. It's just a rollout. The media, everything is on board, and people, their attitudes are on board too. So it could be a very, very strong, sudden collapse of sanity on this planet, actually. Very quick, severe collapse of sanity on this planet. Whatever remaining sanity there is. It could collapse into the belief that confusion is clarity, that fear is happiness, fear is love, that imprisonment is freedom, that failure is success. It could collapse into this Orwellian doublethink condition very fast, and I expect it will. It will be this sudden collapse. People are, now, for example, in the paper we have these, quote, journalists, really propagandists, pushing this whole thing. I read that what they want, for instance, in the NFL, with all this domestic strife situation, is they say everyone should adopt the stance of zero tolerance, guilty until proven innocent. This is what the journalist was championing, saying. And some NFL owner champions, they say, you know what? If anyone is accused whatsoever, immediately suspend them. In other words, guilty until proven innocent. This is the mood of the world that is coming now. Guilty until proven innocent. No due process. The collapse of due process, the collapse of the safeguard, safeguarding our sanity here, you see, where continuity fear cannot just accuse you of something because they think that you're not doing what you want. They want you to do. You see, this dynamic in this world is insanity. Insanity is at work in this world where, again, what we explained earlier, and it's worth repeating, we're so afraid of our true happiness that we insist we have to find it in this dualistic hell here, actually, and within fear, within a stance of hallucination, and therefore we insist that it not come from within us, but from outside of us. And of course, they can never satisfy that, And so we become more and more angry, especially in special relationships, marriage relationships, become more and more upset and angry at the other one, because they're not really making us happy. And they're not, and therefore we feel we need to turn within to find happiness, and that terrifies us. We feel we're going to be annihilated. So we really feel that others are trying to drive us into annihilation. And so this can get very intense, especially in special relationships. Even to the point, and I've gone into this many, many, many times, that this dance of strife involves two people, and it's often not at all clear, you know. It always involves both a collective fear of both of them and a need to somehow structure the situation so that it feels that the problem is out there. So one person acts out being the bad person, usually the bad guy. And so then the other can say, see, my problem with happiness is out there. See that? And the world immediately agrees, yeah. But we have due process to diffuse this. We understand the legal system is designed to at least give us some breathing room. Okay. Where I say, oh, let's calm this all down. Let's diffuse it. Let's go through due process. And oftentimes the people realize, hey, you know, yeah, we were both at fault here. But now we're trying to crush due process. This is a certain sign of the New World Order. It's crushing due process. And there's this overwhelming push in society now. Guilty until proven innocent. No due process required. And of course, to have this, somebody has to be made lily white, innocent. There has to be some locus, nexus of innocence in terms of this dynamic I've talked about in the world, of insisting that the world make us happy, which it can't, and then feeling that the ones that don't do that for us should be annihilated, should be imprisoned, should be fired from their job, should be, you know, just gotten rid of, just disappeared. We don't want you anymore. You've proven you can't make us happy. You know, off with your head. Whereas due process says, hey, wait a minute, the world is not a fair place. The world doesn't make us happy. And we have to learn to, everyone has to learn to shoulder their burden of this. And it's founded in principles of fairness, and ultimately it's founded in religious roots of salvation, the legal system. So the New World Order, and we've had a president, actually, who has championed the New World Order by thumbing his nose at due process constitutionally, continuously. Just saying, look, if you don't want to go through due process, I'm just going to go over your heads and write an executive order. I'm just going to do it anyway. I don't care. I'm tired of this due process. I know what's best. I know. You know, so we've had this extended period of time when this country, where even the leader of this country, the leader of the world in a lot of ways, is setting an example of let's get rid of due process. That's his example. And so, of course, this is emboldened. It's emboldened all the activists who want to crush due process. Now, we're having this play out in the National Football League now, which is an obsession for much of the country. Two football teams now. They're meshed in all this controversy and stuff. One of the teams, the owner, is saying, hey, one of their players has been accused, you know, and they're saying, he says, hey, due process. I'm, you know, this principle of due process is more important than the activists insisting, you know, off with your head, suspend him, you know, bring the hammer down. We know he's guilty. You know, why should we wait and all this stuff? He says, hey, no, due process is more important. See, so there's some, but he's just getting attacked like crazy. And at some point he might, you know, cave under. But that shows at least some decency, still exists, but it's being, you know, pulled up, and then your hand, you know, they're crushing it. They're crushing it. Those are fundamental spiritual principles here on this planet. Don't rush to judgment. Due process. Understanding that due process is designed to get the full story out, and then you realize that hey, you know, they're both heavily invested in what happened. Both heavily invested. Always. It's mutual investment in what happens in this world. Always. That's what Jesus tells us. So we're informed from on high, okay, by one who has no continuity fear, which is super important in a world where you take your highest instructions from those who have no continuity fear whatsoever. They're telling you the truth. They're saying there's total investment from victim-victimizer. They're both heavily invested in the outcome of everything that happens there. And later on, they'll tell you, and when it cools down, they say, yeah, well, it was a mutual investment in this. But what this world is trying to do is insist, no. There's a bad guy and an innocent gal, so to speak. And that's it. This is an attempt to crush salvation, the principle of salvation. It's an attempt to short-circuit the second phase, you see. It's an attempt to take the first phasers and turn them back to delusion and prevent them from getting into the second phase of salvation, which is you realize, yeah, that what Jesus tells us is true. What those who have no continuity fear whatsoever, zero, what they're telling us is true. That we're the ones who are mistaken. We're the ones with the continuity fear. The ones with the continuity fear. We're not thinking straight. We're confused. You don't use confusion to get rid of confusion, which is what the New World Order is doing. They're saying, look, we can get rid of confusion. We'll tell you who the guilty parties are. We'll tell you who the ones are who are not bringing happiness. We'll identify them for you. And we'll all agree, these are the bad guys, you see. And we'll get rid of them for you, don't worry. And this is like music to the ears of the continuity fear. Just, yeah. Instead of recognizing, no, that's not what's going on at all. This world is just an expression of continuity fear. We have to evaporate it. We're totally responsible for our own happiness, which is within us. And then, you see, the continuity fear doesn't want that. So this New World Order is an expression, a bureaucratic, governmental expression of the continuity fear. And they want to crush due process for sure. And they're constantly bringing up these instances. They're manufactured instances, actually. Situations, blowing them out of proportion. The media fans the flames. They're the real culprits, dude, fanning the flames. Okay, I need to go now. Anyway, this is the trouble. And so stay tuned, Feast of Trumpets, September 25th. Let's keep pushing forward for that. Okay, that's it.